Now that you've learned how neurons can send messages, not only down their axons, but from neuron to neuron, we're going to jump into how we're able to sense the world around us. One of the most important characteristics of life is the ability to respond to the environment. In humans, you've likely heard that we have five senses: taste, smell, hearing, vision, and touch. However, this is an incomplete list of all our senses. So what exactly do I mean? For example, we often forget balance is a sense. How about touch? Touch is a very broad term, and when we examine this sense in more detail, you'll see that we can sense specific sensations such as pressure, vibration, and stretch, among others. Let's begin with what all these types of senses have in common. When our body interacts with stimuli, we are detecting changes in the environment. So how exactly are we detecting these changes? Well, similar to how cells receive messages using receptors, we also have cells that act as receptors. For some of these receptors, they might be the neuron itself, like you see here, using a free nerve ending to detect changes in the environment. They might also be associated with supporting cells, like you see here. Another possibility is having a highly specialized sensory cell that is able to sense the environment and pass that information along to a neuron, eventually taking that information to our central nervous system to be processed and interpreted. So when we detect a signal, for example, let's say the pressure from touching the palm of your hand. What is the difference between a light touch versus a strong touch if we had to explain it physiologically? I previously mentioned that action potentials are all or nothing responses, so it's not like we can have an action potential that has an extremely high amplitude. We get the same depolarization every single time. So then, how do neurons signal intensity of a signal? It turns out that signal intensity is transmitted through frequency. Like you can see here, with the weak stimulus, it fires several action potentials. But in the strong stimulus, you can see that many action potentials are fired rapidly. So what exactly does this mean? Let's take a look at an example from the cochlea, the organ that detects sound. In this case, intensity of sound means volume. In other words, a lower intensity of sound means a lower volume, and vice versa. So let's zoom into the cochlea where the hair cells are located that detect the sound. While I won't be going over the whole process of hearing in this video, this is an example that allows us to see how intensity is transmitted. When our ear picks up a sound, it causes the stereo cilia on these hair cells to bend. It turns out that these hair cells have ion channels embedded on their membrane, and when these hair cells bend, it causes them to open. This in turn causes membrane depolarization to occur. Because a mechanical force causes these ion channels to open, we call them mechanically gated. Here, we're going to compare a soft sound to a loud sound. In both instances, each sound causes stereo cilia to bend. But notice that in the louder noise, it is causing the hair cells to bend even more than compared to the soft sound. This results in the opening of more ion channels in response to the loud sound compared to the soft sound, as you can see here. As we now know, opening of ion channels will cause the membrane potential to polarize. In this case, the depolarization travels down towards the sensory neuron that you see in orange. We call this change in membrane potential in a sensory cell a generator potential, as it is generating the signal to detect specific information from our environment. Here is a graph showing both generator potentials. Notice that they have different amplitudes and they are directly related to the intensity of our stimulus. As such, these generator potentials are considered graded. Let's continue to see what happens downstream of this. Based on what we know, the generator potential will trigger the release of neurotransmitter into the cleft. As you can see here, the soft sound doesn't cause that many neurotransmitters to be released, whereas the loud sound results in a lot of neurotransmitter to be released. Anyhow, the neurotransmitter binds to the receptor and excites the postsynaptic cell, which in this case turns out to be a sensory neuron that is part of the vestibular cochlear nerve, which transmits sound information back to our brains. We know that more neurotransmitter in the cleft results in a larger, sustained, excitatory postsynaptic potential. As this larger, longer-lasting EPSP travels to the axon hillock, it will trigger a higher frequency of action potentials compared to our quieter sound. Of course, we can continue this chain reaction even further. In the sensory neuron, a higher frequency of action potential would cause the voltage-gated channels to open for a longer period of time, increasing the neurotransmitter that is released, thereby enhancing the stimulus in the postsynaptic cell. So here, I showed you that signal intensity is encoded by action potential frequency. You can kind of think of it as someone trying to get your attention by tapping your shoulder. You're more likely to realize this person's trying to grab your attention if they tap rapidly and multiple times, instead of tapping slowly a couple times. This is not just restricted to sensory neurons, but every single neuron in your body also communicates through action potential frequency. When we talk about muscle contraction in the future, we will also see that increasing the strength of a contraction in a muscle fiber can be done by increasing the firing of action potentials in motor neurons.